Rajan Mandar from MVLU College. Yeah.
There are also two students from Elphinstone College, which has started doing something.
Yeah, come.
So Neha and Mayur.
Go.
बाहर है कट कर ना बाहर इधर इधर है इसमें
गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स आई एम मंदार फ्रॉम एमवीएलयू कॉलेज And I am studying biotechnology last year. And you are?
I am Raja Prajapati. I am also studying biotechnology in MVLU College, third year.
Mayur Mohite from Elphinstone College, biotech, second year.
Neha Kambe, second year biotechnology, Elphinstone College.
So let's start our topic. Our topic is Pegalopos, rotifer.
One mic is not working, I think. So you may have to use the other one.
So do you know about what is Pegalopos? So as you can see in a picture, there is a manhole and they have a depression in the both side where they can pick up the lid. So there is a depression where the soil and water get collected and it becomes a small ecosystem at your doorstep. So what is Pegalopos? Anyone know about your Galapagos Islands? What is that Galapagos Island? It is situated near South America in Pacific Ocean, nearly 1,000 kilometers away from South America. Each island has partially isolated organism. So the organism in each island may develop differently due to the different environment they get there. So this diversity was studied by Darwin Finches. He discovered several species of finches that vary from island to island. Anybody know about Darwin Finches, what he did? He studied that finches have different beak structure in different island. So why that happened, that in every island to island they have different beaks. So due to the environment, the food they get, what nutrition they get, they changes the beak structure. We are working on Pegalopos. It is a small replica of Galapagos Island. So you can see the Galapagos Island and at a side Pegalopos well. So what type of sample we get from a Pegalopos well? So there are three type of sample. First is a dry sample with we get only a soil, a powdery form of soil, and another one is moist sample that they contain a small amount of water in that. The well is not submerged with the water, just small amount of water, sticky type of soil. And next one is wet. You can see there is a lot amount of water here. Soil may be present. Or the soil is totally covered with a water layer, submerged in the water. So these are the three type of sample. So how we collect the sample? First we look at the well. If there is a presence of leaves or debris, we remove the debris with a spatula. For the good sampling technique, we mix the well to get a homogeneous sample of that. So we mix with a spatula to get ensure that upper and lower layer get mixed. We take a two to three scoop of the soil by spatula into the test tube, and if it is a wet well, so we suck the water with the help of dropper. We fill the half of the test tube, and we label it. How we mount the sample? In dry sample, it is totally the dry powdery soil. So for mounting the sample, we take a suspension of a small amount of soil and small amount of water in another test tube, and we And then we take a small drop of sample from just above the interface of the test tube to mount it on the slide and observe. For moist sample, directly take a soil from a test tube and on a slide and add a drop of water and see it under the microscope. For wet sample, we do it as a dry sample as suspension. We directly take a drop from an interface of the sample in the test tube and we observe. What organism we found in a sample? We don't have enough pictures to show you about the organism. So mostly we found organism in moist and wet sample. The organisms are filamentous algae, allosoma, spirochetes, nematode, rotifer, ciliates, verticilla, bacterial, the spherical we found, and worms. So our model organism, we are working on its rotifer. So rotifer is an aquatic animal. Its name derived from rotating ciliates on a head. I will show you the picture further. It is a filter feeder who drives the water and feed on bacteria, etc. And the organism which are smaller than its mouths, they suck on and feed on that. Its size majorly range from 200 microns to 500. The approx is 300 microns, which we found. It moves in a free swimming manner or a sessile movement. What is sessile movement? Have you seen about a caterpillar moving like this way? So it moves like a caterpillar. Yeah, sessile movement. I will show you that. I have a video about. There are two class of a rotifer: deloid one and a monogonata. So we found a deloid rotifer. This is a structure of deloid one, which we have downloaded. And what we get is this one, deloid rotifer. This is a video of
feeding and movement
of rotifer. You can see the sessile movement now. Now I'll tell you about how we culture the rotifer. In a Moina group, we found that in cup culture of 1 drop of milk in 100 ml of water of culture, they found a rotifer. So we culture in a same manner. We're not cultured in 100 ml of water. We cultured in 10 ml of water. So we calculate the dilution that we add 1/10 of milk, 1/10 drop of milk in 10 ml of water. So which we recorded that the rotifer were growing. So We prepared in a 6-well plate at a mark of 10 ml, and we added a rotifer from the sample, which we get the higher number of rotifer in that. So we just want to get to know that if the rotifer was growing or not. So we just took the sample which have a higher number of rotifer, and we look into the slide and transfer it to that 10 ml culture. Our objective was to find organism. Immediate objective was to find the diversity of the organism in a Pagalapos well. Short-term objective was to isolate a single line of a rotifer. A long-term objective was to study horizontal gene transfer in rotifer. I have not added much thing about horizontal gene, but I will say what is that. The deloid rotifer has only female rotifer. I'm not correct actually, but the deloid one have. I will show you the picture. This rotifer have only the ovaries in the deloid one. So how they in so many generations how they survive without any variations. So there is a paper saying about the horizontal gene transfer, that they took the DNA from surrounding decaying organism such as dead bacteria or something, and they improved the genetic makeup and so they survived the variations that were causing due to the environment. So we had prepared a rough design for that. What we will do, if we successfully derive the single line of a rotifer, then we will compare the desiccation period of the rotifer in moist condition and in wet condition, and they are of same species. So what we will do, if the desiccation period of desiccation and reviving period of the moist well will be very low, it will revive fast, and the wet condition rotifer will revive very slowly. This is a hypothesis of ours. So if we extract a DNA from the moist condition rotifer, and we will add that DNA to that wet condition rotifer culture. So if they are doing the horizontal gene transfer, then we'll take that DNA. The wet condition rotifer will take that DNA, and they will survive the desiccation and improve their reviving period. That's our design for that. Immediate, long term objective for that. That's all.
You said that you have three types of sample: dry sample, wet sample,
liquid.
And you have found that many of the organism in that sample, and you have chosen only rotifer. How you have separated only rotifer from all of that organism from that sample?
I will specify the sample which we get.
It's
a dry sample one which I showed on the this. It's a wet sample one. These have the sample which are high number of rotifer.
Okay.
So I took the sample in the test tube, and I observed in a slide there were more number of rotifer in that sample and less number of other organism. So I used a dropper on the slide. And transfer it to the another test tube, another well. Or six well plate and add the water to see under the dissecting microscope whether the rotifer has transfer or not
by movement. And you said that they are doing horizontal gene transfer. So you are absolutely you are 100% sure they are doing that?
No, we are not sure, we have to work on that further.
Okay.
It is a long term objective.
And I think horizontal gene transfer occurs by three ways: conduction, conjugation, and one more is there.
Yeah, that we studied in a bacteria by the help of plasmid.
So,
but it is a higher organism. It is not a single cellular. But how they do, we don't know.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much.
So why don't you take a very simple marker? You are using a marker, a phenotypic marker of drought resistance or something. What is that you are looking at? Whether it is
desiccation
resistant, is it? So instead of if you wanted to see that whether there is a horizontal transfer of gene, why don't you give some genes which will show up like a fluorescent probe or something, you know, a GFP.
We can try.
Or something like that, you know.
That
no, radioactive
horizontal gene transfer is taking place or not.
So that takes us to the common thing, you know, what are the references that you have? So you mentioned about a paper which talks about it.
Horizontal gene transfer.
So what is that? How do they study that? How did they study that?
Whose
paper is that? Which journal? So we had to have an identity of that, you know.
We don't know exactly.
We don't have that paper.
Anybody remembers about this horizontal? People have been talking about it in cube for a long time. I think Shreyas has been talking about it.
I have the PDF, but I have not.
You have the PDF, locked and kept or what? Okay, so at least could you just send it immediately and start discussing about it? The point is that you should read it along with others. You know, you should you should provoke other people to read it. It's a very interesting concept. I think Shreyas was thinking of giving some antibiotic resistance or something, which I am not very sure whether antibiotic resistance you can test here. Anyway, so we can try some markers. Hey, Abhigyan, you are not asking. She has something.
No, we will sit.
Two of them have something. They have something to say?
Okay, so now we are going for a fruit fly group, Drosophila group. Okay. So we are talking about the three different model systems here, with one addressing one model organism, that is Drosophila. So they will be talking about evolution. Some will be talking about neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. Yeah. So I'm calling Ruchi, Harshita.
Mayur, don't we have some movies to be shown and all that? No movie for Pagalapos?
We have after.
No, Pagalapos, there are no movies? So we will do that after everything is over. That's
We will. After this, we can see movies because we have not transferred in this.
Oh.
We will show in the movie making session.
Yeah.
We have the
time.
Yeah, I have one challenge for the Drosophila group. we heard the Moina group, I hope this is not the only Drosophila group, right? Yeah. Are there more groups?
Ranji, Delhi, Jaipur.
Okay, so I mean, at least while you are presenting it, listen to what the earlier speaker is already saying and try to refer to that and then continue. Because in the morning, for example, in the Moina, we found that a lot of repetitions that each one of you are actually doing it. So, you know, it is better that we refer and then continue. Then as attentive listeners, so that will be a kind of a small challenge that I want to throw to you. So let's see how it goes. Go ahead.
So good evening everyone, myself Ruchi Modgekar, my colleague Harshita Bhanushali, we are from SY Biotech Elphinstone College, and we are working on Drosophila. Our other colleagues, they'll be introducing themselves, she's Nalakshi, Harshali and Naina, who are working on the other projects of Drosophila. So let's start. As we can see, the title is Developing Drosophila as a Model System for Evolutionary Studies. Now, I'll start with what is Drosophila first. We usually find small flies on bananas or any garbage cans. So we usually refer them to as fruit fly. So Drosophila is also a fruit fly. Now, as my title says, evolutionary studies, we have a line called the CSBZ flies. So what's special about this line is, this line was tracked by scientist Seymour Benzer in Canton, USA. So the name CSBZ had C, which stands for Canton, some around 60 years ago. And since then, he has been culturing these flies in media bottles, that is providing them artificial nutrition. And when he was doing his work on that, he distributed the bottles to his colleagues, and that's how we have those flies in cube today, and we are working on those flies. So majorly evolution basically is a very huge topic. So constricting to one thing is we are focusing on natural selection. So as the previous presentation was the rotifers, I don't think I got a very clear idea, but even they are trying to see the rotifers present in different conditions. So one was dry, one was moist, one was wet, and then they are trying to see what are the changes that are found in that those rotifers. So providing some different environmental changes, would that create any difference in their organism is what they are trying to find out. Some sort of similar hypothesis is what we hold. So we have the CSBZ flies, which are, as I said, cultured in media bottles. Similarly, we have Drosophila that is in the wild. So there is a difference in the environment that we are providing to the CSBZ flies. And we are checking a parameter that is olfaction. So olfaction is the sense that we are trying to compare between both the lines, as CSBZ and the native flies. So our hypothesis would give you a little clear idea about it.
So we will be comparing the CSBZ, that is the identified Drosophila melanogaster species, versus the Drosophila melanogaster species which are found in the nature, in the wild. We'll be comparing both of them, and we'll be comparing the olfaction of these both flies. So we have a hypothesis based on this. What our hypothesis says is that the natural the wild species of Drosophila melanogaster that are found in the wild will have a sensitive or a better olfaction as compared to the CSBZ flies. Now why do I say this is if you go to the molecular level of the olfaction, we know that a molecule is sensed by us through nose, so we have receptors. So similarly, even Drosophila have antennae on which receptors are present. So we hypothesize that there could be some mutations in these receptors which could lead to either a positive mutation or a negative mutation. Now positive mutation means the receptors, if I can say that there are some 10 receptors present in the antennae of a Drosophila melanogaster species. So out of those 10, if those 10 are required to identify or to sense just a single molecule, say a banana smell, so there could be a possibility that 5 of them must have got mutated and those might have got inactivated, because of which they could not smell the less concentration of isomalt of the banana. Whereas if I consider a positive mutation, there could be the chances that these 10 receptors could be more sensitive to a very less concentration of banana smell. So if we consider the CSBZ flies, we know that these are the lab bred flies. That means they have been cultured in the laboratory in a special medium, which is called as a Conmeal agar medium. And they have been cultured from last 2000 plus generations. So a particular kind of environment is present in those bottles. Whereas we consider the wild, they are present everywhere. In the wild, there are a lot of molecules that attract a fruit fly. So the native fly has to be more sensitive to particularly attract to a fruity smell so that it can sense its the molecule which it wants to attract.
Even in low concentration.
Yeah, even in low concentration. So that's the reason we say that the native flies should have a better olfaction as compared to the CSBZ flies. And to prove this, we have been leading to our objectives. So as we go to the long-term objective is what I said, that we want to find out we are providing artificial condition to the CSBZ flies. So can this lead to some kind of mutations, to some kind of changes, because of which in a single species you are seeing a kind of variation which can lead us to the concepts of natural selection and evolution. Our second long-term objective is what I said about evolution and natural selection. Our short-term objective is the identification of single-line cultures. Now, single-line cultures are the flies which will be trapping from the environment, and we need to identify them to be Drosophila melanogaster for them to compare with the CSBZ identified Drosophilas. So, the identification process is something that to consider to differentiate between an elephant and a dog, we have some characteristics. So particularly for single species also, we have got some characteristics. So through that procedure, we'll be identifying the single line cultures, and also to prove that there is a better olfaction in the native flies and not in the CSBZ, we need to prove by some experiments. So we have this experiment called as the olfactory assay, which we need to get more replicates, more data of this experiment. So our the immediate term objective is to culture the single line flies and the CSBZ flies in the standard cornmeal agar medium, and also standardizing the olfactometer, just like the RER experiment, the rapid escape response that they need to standardize, wherein they were using different volumes of NaCl and distilled water, and they were providing different amount of time in which they were finding out at what time the earthworm comes out of the test tube. So we started the Drosophila studies 1 year ago, and in some October we started with the olfactory assay. So we started with standardizing the olfactometer. Now olfactometer is an assay wherein we use the larvae of Drosophila we take a plain agar petri plate. In the center we load 10 larvae, and on the end of the petri plate we place a drop of a odorant and a drop which is odorless. So if I place larvae and give it a 1 minute or a 2 minute run, a 2 minute interval of time, the larvae will run. And what we expect is that it should attract towards the odorant. Say I will put a banana drop. We use a chemical over here which is called as isomal acetate, and isomal acetate has got exact smell like banana. So if I put one drop of isomal acetate, that is my sample, towards one side and distilled water towards the other side, I expect the larvae to run towards the isomal acetate. So this is the experiment which will tell us whether the CSBZ larvae have got a better olfaction or the native has got a better olfaction by doing these olfactory assay with different dilutions. So we did this with CSBZ flies, and the first graph shows that we did the olfactory assay with control and the other different dilutions, that is 10 raised to minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 6 and minus 8. And we were first standardizing the olfactometer, that means how much time should we give the larvae to run on the petri plate. So we first started with 2 minutes and we could find out that we did not get the expected results. So if I talk about control is one drop of distilled water on one side and one drop of distilled water on the other side. So if there is no odor in the petri plate, the larvae should run in a random direction. So the expected result should be zero, the ORI, that is the olfactory response index, should be zero. But we couldn't get that. And also when we gave a 2 minute interval of time, we found that the larvae were crawling on the lid of the petri plate as well. So that was not a proper interval of time, and hence we reduced the time to 1.5 minutes. And then we did 10 sets of control with the same CSBZ larvae. And again we found out that the larvae were so quick and moving towards the petri plate lid as well. So we could not get the proper data. So if I place 10 larvae and if out of 10, I give a 1.5 minute interval of time, and if I see that 3 larvae or 4 larvae are on the lid, then I cannot get a data and cannot find out where the larvae are actually moving. Are they actually moving towards the odorant or towards the non-odorant sample? So we again reduce the time to 1 minute interval, and in 1 minute interval we could kind of get a proper data, because in that interval of time the larvae were present on the petri plate itself. So if I place 10 larvae, I could see all the 10 larvae inside the petri plate, and hence I could get my results. And this is the data with the standard deviation. The last one has got a more standard deviation because we were also not we were having some goof ups because we were not taking the number of larvae constantly. So every time we couldn't, we use a brush to take the larvae, and we were not able to take the constant number of larvae, because of which we could get standard deviation.
Do you have a pointer there so that you can show which one?
The standard deviation shows from, for control it shows from 0.5 to plus 0.5 and plus 0.7, which is a huge, minus 0.7, which is a huge standard deviation. So we wanted to perform more replicates of olfactory assay with 2 minute, 1 minute interval timing, because of which we needed more CSBZ flies, and we wanted to culture more CSBZ flies. But again, we got some problems with culturing the flies.
Okay. So as I said, the flies are maintained in the media bottles. So the standard cornmeal agar medium is in what we culture the flies usually. So we initially could, we were able to culture the flies in standard cornmeal agar medium. So when the flies were in proper condition, we tried like to see if the flies could be grown. They are well growing in the media which has distilled water, but it's like distilled water is not accessible to everyone, and it's if someone wants to prepare standard cornmeal agar medium, then there is not a we wanted to say that there is no compulsion for using distilled water. So we were trying making the media with dechlorinated water. So one was the thing that we also had some issues with the pH of distilled water that we were using. So we opted for dechlorinated water, and we wanted to see if that pH thing, does that really affect the life cycle, like hatching of eggs into larva or anything? Does it really affect the life cycle of the fly? And second was the research and development purpose, saying that it's not compulsory to use distilled water for making standard cornmeal agar medium. So what we could observe was the native flies that were trapped from the environment, they grew well in the both the medias, distilled water as well as the dechlorinated water, and we got the next generation of flies in expected number of days. That what we expect is after eight days we should get the new generation of flies. But that of CSBZ flies, the lab bred flies, it was not observed. Similarly, since then we had some issues with the culturing of flies in the proper standard cornmeal agar concentration. So we had different combinations of media prepared for sorting out that issues. So we had medias prepared with acids and without acids. So the normal standard cornmeal agar medium consist of two acids, that is orthophosphoric acid, which is 0.17 ml in 250 ml media, and a propionic acid, which is 1 ml in 250 ml medium. So the function of these two acids is they are both antibacterial and antifungal agents. So we add these acids into the medium. So what we did is again the same thing, to check if pH was the reason why the flies were not the larvae were not hatching out of eggs. And we came to a conclusion that we didn't get the next generation of flies for over quite a lot number of times. So we were thinking that maybe the flies are old, like the lifespan of the fly is approximately 40 days. So the flies that we were using for this experiment were 10 to 12 days old. So the flies were not that old, they were young and fertile. So the eggs should be proper is what we were thinking. So when we prepared the medium, what we observed was all the bottles without acid had contamination, some bacterial contamination. So we didn't put flies into that bottle, so we could not see whether the flies could grow in that bottle. Whereas the bottle which had acids had no contamination, but still the native as well as the CSBZ flies could not grow in those bottles. Only the eggs were observed.
We then shifted our media preparation to half acids and full acids. That is, half was 0.5 ml of propionic acid, and the orthophosphoric was 0.08 ml of orthophosphoric acid in the 250 ml medium. So now why did we do that? Is she said that in no acids medium we could find contamination, and we were not able to properly make those media, and hence we thought that maybe adding a little as in half ml of acid would be better, and we could culture the flies. So we started making the media with full acids and half acids, and again we tested the medium with the CSBZ flies and the native flies. We could found out that the half acids medium could kind of work with CSBZ flies and with native flies initially, but then we again made some goof ups in it, as we got some cultures in the half acids medium. We couldn't get cultures in the full acids medium. But then what happened is, when we started getting the cultures in the half acids medium, we again transferred the flies into different medium. That is, we goof up the mixing of the flies. We added the flies of half acids medium to a full acids medium. So again changing the condition of the media, because of which we again couldn't find the eggs to hatch into larva. And then eventually what happened is that this process takes a little more time. So the parent flies were old enough, with at least around a month old, and because of which we lost both the flies, that is the native flies and the CSBZ flies. Then we got new CSBZ flies from the Sophia College. And we then kind of came to know that the Sophia College people who make the media add very less concentration, less volume of acids into the media. So we thought that if the bottle with the flies is growing in the medium with less volume of acids, then we should also try with the same volume of acids. Hence we shifted to 0.1 ml of both the acids, that is propionic and orthophosphoric acid. And then we found out that the medium was working properly. Initially, we could get the expected life cycle. That is, when I transfer the flies on the next day, I should be seeing eggs. And after 2 days post-transferring, I should be seeing the larva. And again, 4 days transferring, I should be seeing pupa. And again, after proper 8 days transferring, I should be seeing a new eccluded fly. And this we could see with the CSBZ flies, as well as the native single line flies that we were culturing. But then again, we repeated our same mistake that we made earlier with the half acids and full acids. That is, we what we did was, we got the new eccluded flies in the 0.1 ml acids medium, and we mixed them with the parent flies. We mixed two bottles, with the one was with parent flies and the one was with the newly eccluded flies, and we mixed them and we placed them into the 0.1 ml acids medium, because of which we again found out that the CSBZ flies were laying lots and lots of eggs. I could say 500 eggs in each in bottle. We also had replicate bottles, and we could see that the eggs were hatching into larva, but the problem was that the larvae were not pupating. Like after 8 days post-transferring, still the larvae were in the larval stage, and on 9th and 10th day, we could see them pupating, which was not expected. As in, after 4 days transferring, I should be seeing pupa, and over here, I was seeing that the larvae were not pupating in 8 and 11 days. But we had the control bottles, that is the native flies. And we know that native flies in the environment, anytime with different pH or different acids, they definitely can grow. And hence they were our control bottles. And we could find that the native flies were giving us the expected results. That is, on 5th day, we were seeing them pupating. Yeah, we are seeing them pupating.
So now the possibilities of what we came across are two: either the media is problematic or the flies could be problematic. So to eliminate the chance factor, what we did was, we used the same medium in which we just added the newly eccluded flies. Like, we didn't mix the flies that with the parent flies. So this bottle just has the newly eccluded flies, and what we observed was the pupa on the 5th day, which is as expected. So these are the CSBZ flies. Which we initially could not get the pupae on the 5th day post transferring, but in this bottle we can see that. So yeah. Okay, so here the presentation ends. The next group will be taking over.
You are inviting questions
now or? All together.
Now would be better.
Okay.
Now would be better.
Thank you.
Hello everyone, this is Nilakshi and my fellow partner Harshali from Elphinstone College. We will be talking about a very famous yet incurable disease called Alzheimer's, which has been affecting the growing population around the globe every year. So let's talk about the history behind this disease. The Alzheimer's disease was named after a doctor called Alois Alzheimer in 1906, when he examined a patient named Auguste Dieter. She was a German lady. So here we present a small conversation recorded between Dr. Alzheimer and Auguste Dieter. Suppose I am Auguste Dieter and she is my Dr. Alzheimer.
So what is your name?
Auguste.
Family name?
Auguste.
What's your husband name?
I believe it's Auguste.
Your husband?
Oh, no, no, no.
How old are you?
51.
Where do you live?
Oh, you have been to a place.
Are you married?
Oh, I'm so confused.
Where are you right now?
Here and everywhere. Here and now. You must not think badly of me.
Where are you at the moment?
We will leave there.
Where is your bed?
Where should it be?
What are you eating?
Spinach. Oof. So after this conversation, Dr. Alzheimer asked the lady to write few numbers like 5 and 8, where she responded by writing Auguste, and she was repeatedly saying, "I have lost myself."
The major cause of the Alzheimer is formation of plaques and tangles. Plaques are the insoluble deposits which is of amyloid beta. The native protein of the amyloid beta is amyloid precursor protein, which helps in the growth and repair of the neuron. Like other proteins, amyloid precursor protein also gets used up, broken down, and then recycled. It is normally cleaved by two enzymes, that is alpha secretase and gamma secretase. The cleaved product of these two enzymes, it's soluble, which is not problematic. But when the other enzyme, beta secretase, team up with gamma secretase, it cleaves this APP, that is amyloid precursor proteins, in such a way which results in the formation of amyloid beta. This amyloid beta gets sticky and results in the formation of plaques. Another key feature of the Alzheimer is the formation of tangles, which causes neurodegeneration. As we can see in the figure, the neuron, the microtubule are stabilized by the protein called tau, which is microtubule associated protein. On the other hand, in the Alzheimer neuron, this tau protein gets modified due to excess of phosphorylation, which results in the dissociation of this tau protein from the microtubule. This tau protein becomes sticky and forms tangles. Okay. Here we can easily distinguish between the normal healthy brain and the brain of the Alzheimer patient, which is undergoing atrophy.
So for the study of Alzheimer's, we can use two lines of transgenic Drosophila melanogaster, which are GMR-GAL4 and US-Aβ42. So as you can see in the figure, when GMR-GAL4 line is being crossed with US-Aβ42, we get a progeny which expresses Aβ42 in the developing eye. So how does it really work? GMR is the glass multiple reporter, which is a tissue-specific promoter which initiates the transcription of GAL4 gene. On the other hand, upstream activating sequence is an enhancer of a gene that activates the expression of Aβ42 in the progeny. Presently, we have four vials that we receive from IIS Gujarat. One of the line is GMR Aβ42, and the other lines are not being identified yet. We will be confirming about the same soon.
So here is our plan of work. As we don't have the stock culture of transgenic flies, our immediate objective is to maximize the culture of transgenic flies as well as CSBZ. Till now, we have successfully got three generation of CSBZ, and for transgenic flies, we are expecting pupae on the fifth day of transfer. A short-term objective is to study the morphological structure of the transgenic flies as compared to CSBZ, and to study the progression of the Alzheimer disease in transgenic flies through phototactic response. For this purpose, we are planning to construct a phototactic response assay to study this progression in the larvae as well as adult transgenic flies. A long-term objective is to is the characterization of Alzheimer disease at its genetical and molecular level to gain the therapeutic implications for this model. The next neurodegenerative disease will be explained by Naina.
Any questions or something?
So, good evening, one and all. I am Naina, studying DYBSC Biotech in Elphinstone College. So, my topic for my TY's project actually is studying Parkinson's disease in Drosophila melanogaster, PARC13 mutant. So, Parkinson's disease is the second most common neurodegenerative disease. First one is the Alzheimer's, and then second one is the Parkinson's disease. So, it accompanies symptoms such as tremors, muscle rigidity, and postural instability, etc. And approximately 7 to 10 million people around the world suffer from this disease. And most of the cases are sporadic, but then some of the genes are linked to this disease, and those genes, when mutated, can cause this disease. So, for example, those genes are PARC13, DJ1, LRRK, PINK1, etc. There are many such genes. So basically, this disease has three types of cellular defects. So it can be oxidative stress, it can be mitochondrial dysfunction, or it can be abnormal protein aggregation. So any one type of, at least any one type of cellular dysfunction would be seen in, misfunction would be seen in the person having Parkinson's disease. So PARC13, so I am basically working on PARC13 mutant. So PARC13 is a gene which codes for HTRA2 protein, or we can also call it HOMI protein. So it is a mitochondrial protein which maintains the homeostasis in mitochondria, and then it also plays a very key role, important role in apoptosis. Then if this gene gets mutated, then it can cause mitochondrial dysfunction, as it is one of the cellular defects which is found in Parkinson's disease. So due to mitochondrial dysfunction, this mutation of this gene can cause Parkinson's disease. So yes, so Drosophila being an arthropod, why are we even trying to compare it with humans? So basically, it has its 75% genes which cause human genetic disorders homologous in it. So there is this PARC13 gene as well, which is present in this Drosophila. So, and even Drosophila can also perform some motor functions such as climbing. Even larvae can also crawl. So we can even perform behavioral assays with them so as to compare if it has some disease or not, if it is normal or not. Okay, so PARC13 mutant of Drosophila has its PARC13 gene mutated. Okay, hence it displays Parkinsonianism, in the sense it displays symptoms which are related to Parkinson's disease. So this expression of Parkinson's disease in Drosophila can be characterized by performing behavioral assay such as climbing assay. So for example, if I take my CSBZ fly, as these people are taking CSBZ flies, so if I take CSBZ flies as a control, then PARC13 would be my test fly. So if I say that PARC13 mutant is able to climb, say, 12 centimeters of distance within 20 seconds, so that amount of time would be less for CSBZ flies, as they are normal. Okay, so as Parkinson's disease is associated with symptoms such as locomotor defects as well, so I expect the PARC13 mutant flies as well to show same symptoms. So the locomotor defects would be there. So that can be studied by climbing assay. and then some biochemical assays as well, like if there is some mutation in the gene of the protein, it won't be properly formed. Okay, so if there's no protein formation, there would be definitely a difference between a proper classic example, like in CS, there would be some content of protein which would differ as it is in Part-13 mutant. Okay, so in PARC, that can be identified by performing protein estimation assay, such as Fallon-Lowry method. And then I can also do some proteomic studies as well. So my hypothesis is, as for behavioral assay, my hypothesis is CSBZ flies, if taken as control, would take less amount of time to cover a certain amount of distance. Okay, and then when I compare the data, which is of CS flies and PARC-13 flies, so the PARC-13 mutants should take longer amount of time to cover the same amount of distance. So my objectives are to study and characterize the expression of Parkinson's disease in PARC-13 mutant at molecular levels. And my short-term objectives are to perform behavioral assay, which is climbing assay, to perform biochemical assay, that is protein estimation, and then the immediate term objective would be culturing Drosophila PARC-13 mutant flies. So the protocol which goes for climbing assay is preparing a climbing apparatus first. So I took a normal test tube, say 15 ml test tube, and then I marked it at every 1 centimeter interval, as it is shown in the picture. And then my colleagues couldn't explain the preparation of a single line culture though. So when we try to prepare a single line culture, like if there is a bottle which has lot amount of flies, so what we do is we segregate it into another bottle and then another bottle, like that we keep on retransferring them till the time we get only one fly into a bottle. Okay, so in the same way I try to segregate these flies, like 10 males and 10 females for my climbing assay. Okay, so every test tube would be having a single male, and in other test tube there would be single female. Okay, so like that I took 10 males and 10 females. Then the protocol for performing climbing assay would be the apparatus which I prepared would be kept down, and the test tube in which I have a single fly, that would be introduced into that test tube, and then I can dab it, or else just I'll invert it till it goes to a start point. Drosophila is negatively geotropic, which means it will always climb up. Even if I keep my test tube like this, it will go up. Even if I invert it, it starts going to the other extreme end of the test tube. So you can invert it and bring it to a start point, and then once you invert it, you can start the timer and check what time is it taking to cover a certain amount of distance. So I kept distance constant here, which is 12 centimeters. And the results are as follows. So the set one is of flies which were 2 to 3 days old. Okay, so they could climb 12 centimeters of distance within, say, about average of before 7 to 8 seconds. Within 7 to 8 seconds, with a standard deviation of 10, they could climb 12 centimeters. And the set two is of the same flies which were 3 to 4 days old, which were of next day, 3 to 4 days old, and they could also climb 12 centimeters within 7 to 8, with a standard deviation of 9 centimeters. And then the set three would be the same flies, but then they are 1 day old again. So even they showed a average of 6 centimeters, within 6 seconds they could climb 12 centimeters, and then the standard deviation of the time is 5 to 7. So when I compare this graph with the PARC-13 ones, which I perform with, I haven't performed climbing assay with my PARC-13 flies yet. So if I compare this data with the ones which I'll get again, so I hypothesize the time limit which is taken by PARC-13 would be less than the time limit which would be taken by the PARC-13 flies to cover the same amount of distance. Okay, maybe there can be also a possibility that it won't even be able to climb the 12 centimeters. Maybe it will get stuck somewhere between 6 centimeters or 7 centimeters. But then once I get to do the assay, I'll be able to compare both the results and then show it. So my future plans are to perform climbing assay with PARC-13 mutant flies, and then to perform biochemical assays and some proteomic assays, and also try some therapeutics on this mutant strains. So that's all. These are the references.
Thank you. Any questions?
Any particular reference you wanted to refer to?
Yes, actually, the reference which is on the last, it was by Jessica Green, which showed all the assays. Like she, they have performed, the team has performed all the assays like proteomics, and they've also performed some PCR assays as well. Like they've designed a primer, and then they've not with the same mutant, but then they have tried doing it with the other mutant, and I'll be doing with this mutant in future if I get the opportunity to.
You said something about protein estimation and all that.
Yes,
what was
yes,
that?
Yes. Using Fallon-Lowry method.
But why should you estimate pure protein? Why do you think that there will be a major change in the protein?
Because there's a mutation in Part-13 gene in the mutant strain, right? So there won't be any formation of that protein because of that mutation. So there would be a difference between the protein content which is in CSBZ flies
protein
and
content.
Protein amount.
Amount, there will be a change because one gene is not expressed. Do you think that it's a very big, very, very prominent gene, like let's say myosin or actin or something? The muscle. The muscle is made up of myosin. No? So if there is a mutation in myosin, you will be able to see a drastic change in the quantity. Is it not that you should be looking for probably that particular protein in How do you look for a particular protein, whether that protein is missing or whether the protein is in a smaller quantity?
Yeah, we can perform SDS page for that, and then if we add a proper primer or probe which will
primer.
Go probe which will go and attach to that sequence of that protein. So if in PARC13 mutant there is no protein, so there won't be any attachment and we won't be able to see the hybridization over there. So but then in CSBZ flies there would be the presence of that protein, so we'll be able to differentiate using that.
So if it is not there, then that band will be missing.
Yeah, the band will also be missing, and it won't even get hybridized as well.
Yeah, so it's not the total protein estimation that will help you.
Okay.
Total protein probably may not tell you anything different, because in the one extraction from to another extraction, probably there will be some normal variation that you will see, and that will not tell you much, and I don't think it will tell you anything. So what do you think will be the quantity of PARC13 in an animal? Where is it expressed? No idea.
Yeah, it would be expressed, I guess, neurons, in the neurons. Every cell, where is it expressed? Yeah, every
will
cell
it,
should
be
having
a,
some.
So the point is that if it is a structural protein, then it will be in larger quantity. Because the structure is made because of that.
Yes.
Some structure is made because. If it's a functional protein, I think I thought that you said it is a functional protein in some apoptosis or something.
Yes, apoptosis. It plays a key role in apoptosis.
Yeah, so it will be a protein that will be expressed and probably shut off after some time or some such thing. There will be a very regulated expression of that protein.
Yes.
So in that case, that may not be a. So I think you need to be careful about, in the sense, because you are going to do it, why do you want to waste your time doing something quantitative, just a whole lot of things that you are going to estimate, So you can discuss that with the people and in the group.
Yeah, sure. Sir. Sure.
Okay.
Yep. Anybody else?
Any other questions?
Any more questions?
So I thought that we were taking questions after all of them have finished, but that's why I didn't ask any questions to them.
Okay.
Carry on. So, anybody else? Okay, Alzheimer's people, what to say? You have a strain, you have a line, Alzheimer's A-beta-42 or something? Oh, you said that you have three lines.
Three lines, yeah.
So, you didn't tell us that what is, that you said that one you cross with one with the other and you are going to get A-beta-42 expressed somewhere.
Yeah, in the developing eye.
Why?
Prominently in the developing
eye. But why? Why
because
that you should?
GMR is tissue-specific enhancer for the eye photoreceptor cells. But it can also be expressed in the central nervous system.
No, the point is that why are you crossing one with the other to get this expression? What is this GAL4 and stuff like that?
GMR is basically a promoter, tissue specific promoter that initiates Galfour gene.
What is Galfour?
Galfour is a gene that would translate into a protein.
But that's not the Alzheimer's protein.
Yeah, yeah, it's not. But then when Galfour binds to the upstream activity.
You can go back to that slide. Yeah. You have a slide very fast. We don't have much time, no? Okay, I think we'll discuss in your mails, okay, in your messages. Okay, that's fine. But I think there's an issue that you will have to discuss because you went very fast there.
Yeah.
Actually, I want to call Gaurangi because she like she's a single person which is coming for doing the mosquito. We will just have for some time that, and then we will continue the Drosophila. So one more presentation of Drosophila is remaining. Circadian rhythm. I have the data. So yeah. So I will call Gaurangi. She is actually working. She was working on mosquito and mosquito mapping. She was doing from her area in Govandi along with other school students. Now she is in college. Somya College. So now she will be just talking about the what work she has done and it how it is connected to prediction and prevention of dengue basically dengue disease. So I will go on.
Slide is there. She has some slides. So you start, Gaurangi. You start while he prepares things.
I was in Adarsh Vidyalaya school. Myself, Gaurangi Dattaram Duri, and we had our group in Adarsh Vidyalaya school, and also connected to Chembunagar school. Ubed and Ubed Zubed, then some more people were there, and we used to work on mosquito project. We basically focused on Aedes mosquitoes because many reasons are there. One is it is easily identified than other mosquitoes because it has white stripes on it, and we can easily identify it by just looking it. We don't need any microscope or anything to just identify it from other mosquitoes. And then second reason is it spreads dengue disease, means which cause even death if this is Aedes mosquito, and which can even cause death, and it is dangerous. Then we compared our studies to the season cycle, means with we were seeing in which season we'll get more mosquitoes like this thing. So we compared it to the equinox, solstice and things like that, so that we can identify in which season and in which place it would be more mosquitoes. I stayed in Chembur, and Ubed and all that stayed in Govandi. So we had two areas, data and all, and we used to graph it like that. Our methodology was first to trap mosquitoes, and we used our clap trap method. We just used to trap our mosquitoes by just clap trapping it. And we tried different methods, but many were unsuccessful. We tried mosquito trap and it proved to be little bit unsuccessful because we didn't get many mosquitoes with that method. Then we tried with that electric bat method which we have in our rooms, but that used to burn the mosquitoes like that. Then and also there is one method that is what we use, mortein and all that things, but that is harmful for the nature. So we started trapping mosquitoes with our claptrap method only. Then first we used to trap the mosquitoes, then identified into Aedes or non-Aedes, because we focused only on Aedes mosquitoes. There are three types of mosquitoes, Aedes, Anopheles and Culex, but we were focusing only on Aedes mosquitoes. So we identified into Aedes or non-Aedes, and we did it by taking the mosquito on a black paper like this. Here we can see the mosquito, and we can easily identify the white stripes on it. So in this way, we used to identify the mosquitoes. Then one more method we used for seeing the eggs of the mosquitoes. That was ovitrap method, so that we can compare our mosquitoes we used to trap mosquitoes now, so we can compare with that with the eggs of the mosquitoes. So hence Zubair and all that, we together made ovi traps. These are the ovi traps which were made. We kept some ovi traps. We used to keep some ovi traps in the cube campus also, and some were kept in our school campus and such. And where we used to catch the mosquitoes, there we used to keep the ovi traps. We used to take these eggs and see and compare that to our means mosquitoes data. Then here it is written how to make a ovi trap. You should just take a prepare plastic cups. Then this is the method how to make ovi trap. Then you should take normal plastic cup, cover it with a black paper, or you should color it, anything, but black paper is more good. Then fill the cup half with water, means this much 250 ml cup we used to take generally, and used to cover it half with water, means any way like that. Then we used to wrap it. Then used to take a normal scale or anything like stick or thing like that, and used to cover it with white means what we can say, cloth or something like that, paper, so that we can see the eggs on it. Then we used to label it and keep it outside and check whether the mosquitoes has laid eggs on it. And after we used to see the eggs and all, we used to compare, we used to destroy that eggs and all by means putting it in the detergent water and all, so that it doesn't harm our nature. Then Zubaid, these are the eggs which are found by Zubaid in his house. You can see the small, small eggs. This is written how to differentiate between the eggs of mosquitoes. These are Anopheles eggs, and these are Aedes eggs, and these are Culex eggs. Culex eggs are in group, means it is joined and group like that. But and Anopheles and Aedes have means separate single eggs we can find. But again, there is a difference between Anopheles eggs and Aedes eggs. Anopheles eggs have this means little bit, you can see that difference easily. Then we made hypothesis. So according to season, we made the hypothesis like this is total mosquitoes. Actually, this is total mosquitoes. By mistake, it was written number of non-Aedes. It is actually total mosquitoes. And from that, how many were Aedes like that? So according to me, means generally in rainy season, total mosquitoes, the number will be less, but Aedes percentage will be the highest. And normally in March or something season, like means before rain or means summer season, we'll have most number of mosquitoes, and Aedes mosquitoes will be very less like that. That was my hypothesis. And Ubaid also was there, so according to him, means Ubaid's hypothesis shows that total number of mosquitoes will also be more in means rainy season, and 80% percentage will also be more in rainy season. So that was Ubaid's hypothesis. This Aedes hypothesis was same for both of us, but difference was in total number of mosquitoes. According to me, total number of mosquitoes would be most like we can see here before rain, means summer season like that, March and all. But according to Ubaid, the total number of mosquitoes would be most for June, July, means rainy season. This is actually hypothesis result, but it is not confirmed, because that is only according to my data. So we cannot depend completely on that. We'll still find more data. Again, the slides are not open. According to that data, means it is showing that. According to that summer, it is most mosquitoes are there, and June I got the least amount of mosquitoes, and 80% percentage was also more in that. But the data means total number of mosquitoes, that data keeps on changing. Means summer it was means March and all, it was the most, but again it kept on changing from July, August and all like that. And again it started increasing from December like that. This is 1 year data, 2017-16. Yes.
In July there will be more of dengue fever. Do you have any data like that from Bombay Municipal Corporation or Public Health Department or something?
No, not.
So it will be good.
Actually,
to take
I
that.
Had some data, but I didn't. I think it is not here in this slide.
No,
I got it from the municipal corporations that dengue cases and all. So I don't remember.
See, your data shows that in July there's a spike.
Yeah.
There's a little increase in your
total number of mosquitoes.
Not total. Aedes, we are interested in Aedes, you know.
Aedes, yes.
Aedes, there's an increase.
Yes,
so do you think that time there will be an increase in the illness
dengue
also?
Cases. Yeah, I think.
So what did Ubaid get? Do you have any other data of anybody else?
No, that only I said because I didn't had any other data, so we cannot depend on that.
So Ubaid doesn't have any data?
No, it is not.
Okay, fine.
So that means we cannot completely depend on this
so
data.
So that means you would suggest that people should be taking more data on this?
Yeah. Yes. We have to do proper studies and find the data.
Now, proper means you will have to just carry out studies in different places. Like
yes,
Ubaid, if he has done it, it would have been but good.
Yes,
and
sir.
In your place itself, I think there should be more people doing it.
Yes, sir.
So why don't you ask your juniors to do that?
Yes, sir.
It's a very useful thing because you can predict it and the municipal corporation can take precautions.
Yes, precautions.
Much more seriously than otherwise.
Yes, sir. And our project mainly based on that only prevention and prevention that should be taken upon the predictions that we made.
What?
But afterwards, we cannot predict on a single data. We need more data. So we need more people to join in it and find the data and then we can predict in our areas like that.
So why didn't you do it this time?
Yes.
Because July is ending. So can you do it tomorrow onwards?
Yes, sir. But we'll have to find more people.
You can start it so others will join.
Sir. Any questions?
Okay, so now we will continue with the Drosophila things. So. So I would like to actually start from something about Drosophila because now we have three presentations on Drosophila we had, and then so this is another. So basically we covered about olfactory studies and also about diseases through Drosophila as a model for several diseases like Parkinson, Alzheimer. Now I will just talk about something. This is a contribution made by it is coming from Pathambi, that is the place in Kerala. Okay, so this is a study of activity pattern of Drosophila using the Drosophila trap. Means activity pattern in the sense that every organism has some kind of, you know, activity. You can say a pattern, you know, which everybody follows. For example, we human beings wake up in the morning and we sleep in the night, you know, and dog actually does the opposite. Dogs actually, if you see, they will be sleeping in the afternoon actually. If you go to any railway station or you see on the street, they will be all sleeping in the afternoon. But in the night, they will be barking. They will be very active, okay? So in the night, if you midnight, you just observe them, you know, just hear them, you will see that they are barking, okay? So what is actually happening is they have so this is actually the rhythm. So there's a sleep-wake rhythm in our body, which is different from the sleep-wake rhythm of a dog, for example. And similarly, so people are actually studying in whether it is same, it is also like that in the Drosophila. So whether Drosophila will also be active in some part of the day and whether they will be inactive, for example, in another part of the day. So this is they have actually, what is the methodology? They actually take some of the, they trap the flies. So this fly, actually fruit fly, is actually what you call, they are attracted towards the banana. So they take some, you know, the peel of the banana and they put it in the plastic bottle. I will just show you that also. But so, and then they actually clean the mouth of the bottle with the tissue paper. And then they keep the bottle in front of the, for example, garbage bin, because now they will be attracted. So garbage bin have a lot of Drosophila, fruit fly actually. So so then they actually, after some period of time, for example, every 2 hours, they will go and they collect the bottles and they will count the number of flies. Okay, so what happens is they have seen actually that some kind of, you know, so this is a different type of localities, different people, and they have different time intervals in which they are actually trapping the fruit flies. And so they are actually, yeah, so this is how they are actually doing. Prepared the bottles, taken the banana inside the bottle, and then, yeah, before bottles were set with banana peels and pieces for attracting the Drosophila. This is how they are doing. Okay, and then they actually collected the numbers they calculated. So this is their data actually. I'm presenting their work. So they have collected. So this is a, for example, they are actually getting some 19 flies for in the first first reading. It is 19 flies at 12 to 2 p.m. That is the maximum flies they are getting. Means at between 12 p.m. to 2 p.m. maximum flies are attracted towards the banana. It doesn't mean that rest of the time they don't like banana, or they are not, you know, they are not attracted towards banana, but they may be inactive. No, they may be, for example, sleeping, or they will be doing something else, you know, some other behavior. So, and the other thing is, so the same second person, that is Shrishma, is getting 10 flies in the 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. right? Yeah. And then again, so so actually they should be taking, now this is not a complete data, this is just a kind of initiation, I will say. So like that also, the same other group is that from the Kochi. So what our idea is, that if you have, for example, 50 people doing this, okay, they will get this kind of data, and from different places also, then they can plot a graph. Okay, so after plotting the graph, they will find something like this. Number of flies, oh, I think it is not visible. Okay. From currents. Yeah, so here they are actually getting 10. These are the number of the flies on the y-axis, and at the x-axis, it is the time period. So, and at 14, that is 2 p.m., they are getting maximum flies, that is 10. Okay, so it means that at some period of the, for example, 12 o'clock to 2 o'clock, they are very active. This graph is showing that they are very active in that period, and rest of the time, the number of the flies are very less. So so that means that peak activity they are checking. Okay, and then whether it will be, you know, active also during the night, for example. So if you do in the night, 9 o'clock p.m., 9 p.m., then 11 p.m., then 1 o'clock a.m. okay, 3 o'clock a.m. whether they will be sleeping. I like us. So you think that Drosophila will also sleep? How many of you think that Drosophila will sleep? And they will also sleep like with the time in which we sleep. Nobody.
They don't have eyelids.
Huh? Eyelids. Acha. So we don't know how. So how do you actually detect that somebody is sleeping? How do we know that the person in front of us is sleeping? What are the indicators? Are there any indicators of the sleep? Mike, can you give the mic some? Okay, anyways, this is from coming from Kochi. This is from Kochi, okay? Yeah. No, he wanted to say something. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
No, I mean the person or the organism go into the rest motion.
No, loudly, thoda.
Means the organism or the person go into the rest motion in some way. Yeah, I mean.
But how? What does the rest means? How? If even I'm standing like this, does that? Is it called as rest? I'm taking rest.
No.
Then what is rest?
But at that time, means we have indicated that our eyes are open and you can see.
Okay, so eyes can one, eyelid can one of the, can be
indicator,
one of the.
Indicator, yeah.
Huh?
Huh, eyes, for human being, eyes can be a one.
And
indicator.
what else, other than eye, what can
our
be?
Our mid, if we can talk about internally, so yeah, our muscles get relaxed and our metabolic process get into lower state.
Hmm.
Means it get lower.
Hmm.
And the brain does not have to perform that much of activity when we
how do you know brain is not performed? Because brain anyways we will get the lot of dreams, so I will say that brain is very much active, you know.
But when we are not sleeping, we are doing some kind of actions, so brain is not focusing on dreaming, so that means jo work hota hai wo actions ke
usse, okay, so
that much of work is not will load on the brain.
Okay, so some part of the brain could be, you know, some functions we are not performing. So that part of the brain could be inactive, you know, not doing anything. Or it could, or other thing is, it could co-opt some other function. It will be doing some other function at that time. That is also possible. So these are kind of indicators. You know, one of the clear indicators, you said eyelid, other is muscle. For example, if somebody is sleeping, if I push that person, he will not respond, he will not move. So that is the thing. So even flies, what people do is, so you can identify whether the fly is, when the fly is sleeping. So one of the ways, whether they are attracted towards food, you know, and whether they are, if you push the fly, whether the fly will move. If it is sleeping, if you just, you know, take a brush and just try to, you know, push the fly and it will not move. Otherwise, you know how the flies are. You have seen any flies in the bottle? Anybody saw?
Yeah.
What are they doing in the bottle?
They are moving always.
They
are
always moving. And
yeah,
where,
randomly.
Like, whether they will, which part of the bottle will be maximum flies?
Upper side.
Will they be down? They will be like in the on the floor?
No. Most of the time, they are on the upper side, I think.
They are. Why are they upper, on the upper side? Somebody did climbing essay something. Na,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Naina was telling something.
Can you say something? Okay, this is banana peels.
Because they are negatively geotropic. Like why? They always why? Tend to go towards the upper side.
But why?
No, not when they're sleeping. I guess they'll be somewhere near the media when they'll be in this resting period.
In your bottle, if for example in climbing essay itself, you take climbing essay different time period in the same same thing, and whether you will find that in some time they are not climbing.
They won't move. Yeah, yeah.
They are not climbing itself. So that could be one of the way to check.
Suggest
that climbing essay should be done when it's in the activity
peak. Activity peak, yeah.
So
okay.
One day she does it at the activity peak time, another day she does it when the lower.
The data may differ.
She will get some fluctuations
Yeah, and it all. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So in the night they get
Parkinson's. Right. So these are the things like, so these are the one of the, so what we are doing is we are actually developing an essay. So this could be a climbing essay itself can be used for the sleep studies also, you know. So the same people who are doing climbing essay or these people who are actually studying, you know, flies activity, they can use the climbing essay and they can study the sleep circadian rhythm through that. So that is a very interesting part of it. So.
Isn't it a good idea?
You know. I mean, we have been doing a lot of other behavioral essays, you know, particularly, you know, RER we have been doing, and we are also working with the larvae. We are doing the regular olfactory essay. And with regard to the flies, you know, it sort of introduces to the research methodology a little more easier, because you have to trap flies, maybe have enough number of flies, that's all you need. And after that, you know, you can collect a lot of data in a sufficient amount of time. So, I mean, I really appreciate that we have now introduced this as well, so that, you know, more and more people can learn how to do science, because, you know, most of these are paradigm cases of doing science. You know, you can introduce statistics, you can talk about the range of values, you can learn about standard deviation and things like that. So it becomes a very nice model system for us. I think we should talk more about this particular climbing essay as a method. And as you said, it may be also useful for sleep studies as well.
Hmm. Yeah.
So I would expect more such essays in the coming events.
Yeah, loudly, mic. Yeah.
What they presented on a data that the more flies are attracted towards the banana smell between the time of 12 p.m. to 2 p.m.
2 p.m., yeah, something like that, yeah. Close to it, that.
I think we are only focusing on sleeping, that they maybe are sleeping, but I think that can be also be considered that their olfactory are more activated on that time only.
But why? For example, if you say that they are only activated in that kind of that period,
means
if that period is they are not getting any food, which is likely in the nature, in the wild, they will be dying actually, because they are not even the food is there, they are not able to sense the food, so they will perish.
Maybe because of
so
environment.
Food, see, there is no timing in the, there is nothing like, you know, at 12 o'clock only the food somebody is giving, you are giving, going and you are feeding the flies, nothing like that. Na? So they actually, that is very harmful. If they have such kind of thing, that is very harmful for the fly. So they will not evolve, basically.
Okay.
Such kind of fly. Okay, so yeah, now we will go for the next things. So we actually have some of the collections from of the movies, lot of movies. So flies also, I will just, as we talked about trapping the fruit flies. So we have some of the flies from lot of places we have. So I will just show some fruit fly trap. So yeah, this is from this is the movie from Rachi, which is sent by Binita. She is from the Rachi college, you know, and then she is actually working from lot of time in the fruit fly in cube also, and basically she's working in the fruit fly model, and she has established a lab there. So some of the her work I'm showing here in her home also. Yeah, we will have that presented. Can somebody switch off these some lights? These lights, if ठीक, ये भी light कर दो. Voice का I don't know मेरे होगा क्या उसमें. आवाज़ है क्या? Audio है क्या? किधर? ओके देखो कहाँ पे करना है कर इसको वाइडर
आपका इधर से आपका साउंड इधर से भी नहीं आया इधर साउंड नहीं आ रहा है ना आपका
इधर तो आते हैं
इधर किधर आ रहा है इधर आना चाहिए तो इधर आएगा एक मिनट पहले इसको आने तो करता हूँ
ये बहुत फुल किया
है इसका ही साउंड नहीं
फटफट आ रहा है कुछ इसका फटा हुआ जा सकता
है
नहीं आ रहा नहीं होगा आवाज
नहीं होगा वो इसका ही नहीं साउंड आ रहा है
Okay, anyways, we'll have the repetition. So trapping of fruit flies at the home. So she is doing working actually at home. Thank you. repeating again. Okay, done. Then okay, then we have other also, like some of the traps, which is okay. These are some of the flies which they are trapped. So these are the how the flies look like, and these are actually some gravid females. They are. This is from actually Kochi. Okay. ये connected ही नहीं निकला. Charger connected. Charger is connected. Then okay. Charger connected. Charger connected. Right. Okay, and then we have another one, which is this is the some of the pictures from the Kochi. So this is from Venikode, in which they are actually doing the same kind of activity, and they are also involving lot of students basically. So these are the school students which they have introduced. School students are also basically doing this kind of fly trapping activity. So it's actually a large scale activity which is going on currently. You can see the pictures. And then we will move to the next things, like, you know, we have other contributions also from different places. For example, you know, there is a one kind of movie. So I will just now screen lot of movies which are coming. So this is the movie from Zebra Fish. This is again from Vinita, and she is collecting again from at the home. She is doing this maintenance of zebra fish at home. Fish tank at your cube center. Does anyone have fish tank, or at home also? Does anybody have fish tank at home? No. Okay. But so zebra fish, actually, why they are raring is this actually zebra fish which she has shown. She has actually collected it from the Ganges, you know, the river, and then she actually went to that place. And you know, fortunately, she found some of the zebra fish, and she collected those zebra fish, and then she brought here, and then she is doing that maintaining zebra fish at her home. Yeah. Which one? That one, Michelin Blue, that is not why she will add Michelin Blue, you think so?
That's my question.
Okay. Antibacterial as well, as it is, you know, it reduces, it's an oxygen, receives the oxygen, so it's a reducing agent. So it will, you know, lot of bacteria will be killed because of that. So you can also start some, because zebra fish is available in any aquarium shop. So you can also start this kind of activity in your center. Huh?
You can find the answer.
No, but it is not forwarding actually. That is, yeah, wo nahi ho raha tha. It is starting again from the beginning. Okay. Yeah. Then we have also the earthworm. Anyways, we have seen the earthworm, but this is from Rachi College. Okay. Next, we have some samples from of Pagalapos. So these are some of the Pagalapos organisms which are already we have seen Pagalapos. So this is how they are doing at their place in Rachi. This is using simple microscope they are doing, and simple plastic, you know, bottles and everything easily available. Then we have another movie which is from about planaria. So I will just start this. So planaria, how many of you know planaria already? Have you heard any time planaria? A flatworm actually it is. So it is actually a model system for well-known model system for regenerative studies. So we actually got planaria from Bangalore. So this is the video from Kochi College, and one person Abhishek, who is actually trying to maintain it, and he has been able to culture that. So he's just making a video of the method, how he's culturing the planaria. So this is how planaria looks, the ones which we show. Abhijit Vinod. Then we have another video from, this is a, I think you have seen also rotifers. So this is one of the video of the rotifers. So this is actually, these are the organisms which are plenty found everywhere. So if you take any sample from, you know, outside this campus also, you will see lot of, you know, these kind of organisms, and they have lot of studies. I think they have already covered in the Pagalapos. So this kind of organism also people are studying in Q. Now I will just like to cover the the Think Lab, which is a group. This is an orientation actually presentation, which actually the group presented when the new freshers joined the ANDC college. So they actually had this kind of, you know, they already have the lab of Cube Lab, and when the freshers came in the orientation program, they presented Cube to them. So this is their presentation. So sophistication is some of the things which are covered in this, the memories also and lot of history also. Sophistication is required in mines and not in the labs. So Think Lab is an autonomous lab of the students which works without any supervision of teachers. It is in collaboration with Cube, Homeova Center, TIFR. So these are some of the pictures of their, is this what science has become? Okay, they are talking about education anyways. Education system, and then the more stupid your questions are, the more conceptual you go. So they are actually encouraging the stupid questions. Okay, so any question is very important. Questions are very important. Think Lab was an initiative of the students by the students for the students. We believe in using simple model systems to discuss some frontier questions in biology, understanding the process of science, observation, hypothesis, experimentation, recording, collaboration, rather than emphasizing only on product of science, facts and theories. Science gossips, so they also have this gossip kind of things where, for example, if they go into the, you know, garden, they will start the discussion. They will, any canteen, they can start the discussion. In Science Cafe, a knowledge studio, it's a science cafe. Discussion at India Gate Lawn. Intense, he's Sarthak, who actually also worked on a lot of things on Moina, and Parkinson actually model, he was studying in Moina. So you can also collaborate with Sarthak in case. Catching bees, these are the bees group, which they started, mapping the diversity of the bees in wild as well as the city, urban areas. Caring of model organisms, so I think this is a vermipit. Preparing compost for earthworms. These are the model organisms which they have, snail, butterflies. So one group is also working on a lot of diversity of butterflies. Field trips and excursions, okay. Cube, okay, then a good time during Cube Autumn Meet. So they also like conduct meetings there, and also they come to the Mumbai. So these are some of their meetings in Mumbai, 2017 meet. Cube workshop 2018, this is a last, I think, June workshop. So 2 months, I think 1 or 2 months back, this workshop was there. So this is April and May workshop. Chai Pe Charcha, okay. There is an interesting discussion at Dayal Singh College. So Dayal Singh College and ANDC College both are collaborating with each other. Causeries. Causery means they are also having this kind of discussions at their place. You all know this is our group's WhatsApp group mailing list. So they also went to some conference, which we also, some of them, when they have some kind of, you know, interesting story to present, they also go to conferences and they present their work. So this is IAN, Indian Academy of Neurosciences conference, which was in Chandigarh. So they presented their paper there also. They also presented at JNU. Okay, these are some achievements. Winning movement by our thinkers. Okay. Some first college first certificate. Anyways, thank you. Okay, so I will just like to, in 1 sec, like 5 minutes, I think, yeah, I will just cover up, you know, some of the things like what we are actually, these are some of the model systems you also always saw. So then what we have also, this is a weather chart. So we have one kind of activity in which we actually call it as V and weather, in which we look for, you know, climate or weather of our environment. For our surrounding, for example, you know, you just have to take the print of this, you know, and then or you can also make this kind of chart, which actually has date, you know, and then it has sunrise sunset timing. So anybody knows what is the sunset? So do you think that sunset is already happened now outside? Okay. So this is how, like, so every day will the sunset and sunrise timing will remain same year long? So it always keeps changing. And lot of these activities which you are checking about, the Drosophila activity, for example, is affected by the sunrise and sunset timing. Okay, so these kind of things are actually the factors which affect the whole thing which you are studying. So these are the factors. So you have to note all these factors when you are doing an experiment. So this is kind of, you know, you should make it like, you know, daily kind of record you have to make. So people actually started this sunrise sunset timing. You have to note down day length, day night, day length, night length timing, temperature, high temperature and low temperature, maximum and minimum both. Then humidity also you can measure. So these are the kind of thing you can have to practice, and it will be, you know, if you collect this from different places, you will get a lot of idea of the climate of our country, and it will be correlated with the behaviors. Lot of behavior of, for example, mango tree. So we also have mango tree and gulmohar tree activity mapping. So we are actually doing a lot of mapping from across the country. People are mapping mangoes, gulmohar trees, peepal trees, copper pot trees. So like this, we have a lot of activities which will be, this kind of will be applicable for that. So you can also start this kind of activity. So this is just a normal thing, you know, it will not take any time. It will take only 5 minutes, and you just have to enter this and send the data. And it will get, we have to archive it. That's the thing.
Can you connect it to your R&D and show one of the
paper? Oh, it will be difficult. Just check, yeah. Yeah, I will just show one thing. Yeah, okay. Also, I will like to show the, when I said about the mangoes mapping, so I will just show the map of the mango flowering which we have. These are the maps which we have of, this is the latest map actually. So we have been doing the mango mapping studies from last year. So these are the kind of, you know, these green things represent that mangoes are already, you know, fruiting, and yellow ones represent that mangoes are flowering. So this is the map of February-March 2017, and the last map which we have made is, and this is December 2017. So all these are the places where things are happening in the country. This, the purpose of showing this map is, we want to show that, you know, these are the places which are actually the locality hubs of the cube, and lot of things they are doing in collaboration from here and with, along with all of you. So yeah, you said something this
Your R&D should be having A4
movie. Okay.
One, if you can show it, help you watch it.
Yeah. These are all the centers around the cube. These are cube hubs. Red ones are the cube hubs, and blue ones are the nodes around that. So No, I'm not able to open it actually. Sir, you have anything? What you were saying? Jaipur. But I'm not able to open the No, I don't think there's a net, some problem in the net. Anyway, so we will move. There's one more video which you have. So Drosophila group has one video. So I will just like to call Drosophila group to. Can you just come? And you have one video, no? Ajo na idhar ek jan. You have to show, no? Yeah. Kaha pe hai? Main batau na isme. Haan, phir isko open karna hai. Demo nahi. देखो ये सही नहीं हो रहा नेटवर्क नहीं आ रहा शायद ठीक है तुम्हारा कहाँ पे है ये ओके तो ठीक है इसको ऑन कर दो
Is this some sort of medium or something? Yes, we are making Omnilagar medium. So these are ingredients. This looks like maize powder. I think it is the major source of carbohydrate.
Oh right, that seems to be sucrose, which is also a carbohydrate source.
Then what is this?
This is dextrose, which is also a carbohydrate.
It's smelling bad. What is it? This is yeast extract, which is a huge source of proteins and vitamins.
Oh, I have that. Why are you three sources of carbohydrates?
It's simple. More the carbohydrates, more the nutrition they get. But do they consume all the carbohydrates? Yes, they consume the whole media at once. But utilization of energy is first from dextrose, which is a monosaccharide.
So sucrose and later maize powder are utilized because they are complex?
Exactly. It means one bottle can hold slice for at least 30 days.
Shouldn't the media be solid or is slice will get stuck and die?
We must be adding agar or something, right?
Yeah, we add 2% of agar.
Okay, so now I'll go and get agar.
I'll get agar.
Okay, so I'll put the paper over here. Tear it so that the weight of the paper does not come in.
Waiting on the
So this is our laminar airflow in which we will be pouring the media into the bottles. We have our media autoclave. We have the autoclaved bottles ready. And these are the acids, that is orthophosphoric acid and propionic acid, which we add into the media, after which we pour them into the bottles. Propionic acid is an antifungal as well as an antibacterial agent, as well as orthophosphoric acid is an antibacterial agent. This is not the standard corneal agar composition because we change the concentration of acids. Usually orthophosphoric acid is 0.17 ml but we add 0.1 ml. Composition 1 ml of propionic acid is added, but we add 0.1 ml of propionic acid. Now that the acids are added, we'll shake it properly so that the acids gets equally mixed. Now in each bottle, around 25 to 30 ml of media will be added.
Now it ends. Okay, so we will be calling off with this, and I will like to just call Arunan sir to just give two words. Yeah. Mike.
The Jaipur group's movies we could not show, and they were sort of watching.
It is not opening actually.
Otherwise, I think so good. As I started saying that it's only the beginning. Yeah, whosoever are there, we are continuing, right? So that's it. Hope to hear from you every day. Yeah, whatever you are doing. Thank you very much. So keep on posting your work and plan and worries, yeah, and what you are reading. Okay, thanks a lot.
Trying to reach phone. Nikal de hai.